All right. Well, good morning, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants event. My name is Joe Grabowski, and I'll be your host for today. It's always a ton of fun to do these calls with Hearts in the Ites. It's kind of like a virtual field trip and a guest speaker adventure all mixed into one, because we have so many great speakers joining us live today for today's event. This month's theme is mental and physical health. If you joined us last week, we connected with Grosando, who does some amazing work working with polar explorers and astronauts, learning about what it's like to train for and to be in areas of extreme isolation. And we also had astronaut Nicole Stott join us, and she shared with us some amazing images and experiences from when she left our planet. So we're rolling along today with another exciting event. In 2019-2020, Sunniva Sorby and Hilde Strom made history when they became the first women to overwinter in Svalbard solo. They spent 12 months at the remote trapper's cabin, Bamsebu, located at 78 degrees north and 140 kilometers from the nearest town of Longyearbyen in Svalbard. Climate change isn't taking a break, so neither are they. They returned to Svalbard in November and will be overwintering again at Bamsebu until May 2021. This time, though, they've got a team of 10 global partners making Hearts in the Ice the ultimate bridge between science and global citizens to better understand climate change and why we all need to play a role. So they're going to continue to serve as citizen scientists on a variety of projects, from observing clouds and the auroras to flying drones to monitor ice and collecting phytoplankton samples as they build on their second year of data collection. So joining us live, 140 kilometers from their nearest neighbor in Svalbard, we have Hilde and Sunniva joining us via sat phone. How are we doing today?
Hi, everybody. Hi, Joe. We're doing great. Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, we love that we can connect with you from such a remote area. The connection has been so great these last few events, nice and clear. And we're excited for a little update and to talk a little bit about this month's theme.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. It's Hilde here, and I will share some updates, and then soon I will talk about the themes of the month. So this is our second winter, and the last winter was like a polar winter should be. It was cold, and we had sea ice. And this year, it's really way different. It's mild, and we have had so much rain.
I think our connection might have just dropped our connection just dropped via sat phone. So I'm going to give them a moment just to pop back in with us. They're going to have to redial quickly, and then we'll get things rolling again. And then I'll share my screen too. They sent me a couple images today, some cool pictures to show what they've been up to. So here we go. They're coming back already.
Yes, we're back. Sorry, Joe. Where did you lose me?
You just finished talking to us just a little bit about how the conditions are so much different, where you had so much ice and snow last year at this time, but it's so different this year.
It's a way different winter. It's so mild, and that has been the trend the last 10, 15 years, actually. So this is part of the climate change up in the Arctic. So we have no sea ice here. And we're collecting as early as December, we collected ice core samples. This late December, we're doing paddling with a kayak and collecting phytoplankton in the open ocean. So, and this means that the reindeers are struggling, just no sea ice and or rain and warm winter also means it's ice on land, on the tundra, and they are trying to scrape their way through to their food. And the same thing with the polar bears, they're struggling too because there is no sea ice and their main food source is seals on the ice. So this is way different, and it's a struggle for the animals up here. And we're actually, Joe, you have a picture of me or us collecting both seaweed this winter and also plastic on the shore, trash and plastic that's washed up by the ocean. So it's really a different and difficult winter up in the Arctic. And before I... send it over to Sunniva. Maybe you can show the picture of the 14 days challenge So we are halfway through, and it's there is one thing on that list that we can't handle here at Bamsebu. I mean, no shower is not a problem because we haven't been showering for 14 months. But the food, the plant-based food is difficult for us. But otherwise, we are way in there. So Sunniva will talk about the themes. Do we still have you, Joe?
We're still connected.
Okay, thanks. Just for the record, Hilde and I have spent 14 months in isolation, and we calculated over 10,000 hours together, and we're still best friends. So lots of tools in our toolbox. Part of keeping our health in check way up so remote in the Arctic is having a purpose, having something to do that's meaningful. So if all of you can think of a toolbox that has both hard and soft tools for health and coping, our hard tools, if you can tee up the photo of us with our Lynx snowmobile, Joe, in the Aurora, our hard tools are things like our snowmobile that get us out. We were just out a few hours ago and rode to the other side. The moon is half full, and it's just beautiful sky out there. And this Lynx gets us out to collect plastic traps, some of that marine debris you saw a photo of, and to take photos of the Aurora. And then we have other hard tools, like if you can tee up that photo of that big orange pelican case, that's our doctor in a box. It's a Marlink telemed kit, and that's a watertight case that can help us make a video call with our doctor in case of an emergency because we're so far away. And then soft tools in a toolbox are things like, how do we cope up here? How do we take care of ourselves? And how do we communicate with each other? So we use things to keep us healthy, like fitness bags, fitness bands, and we do yoga 6 days a week. We eat pretty healthy, but like Hilde said, we can't eat plant-based food. So if you can tee up that photo that we're dreaming about of Pascal, who is in Montreal with a lot of greens from her garden, we are running out of fresh fruits and vegetables, but we have just about everything else here. So really huge appreciation and thanks to Devolt for being our partner in the theme this month, which is mental and physical health. And I really, like, a very, very big thank you. We are honored to have you, Tamara, joining us from my hometown in British Columbia, Canada, and Roz, who I believe is in the UK right now, joining us. So you're all in for a treat, and back to you, Master Joe.
All right, excellent. Well, thank you so much for sharing with us, giving us a little update. You know, what an experience that you're having up there. And it's just, it's so great to get these updates and hear about how things have been going. So right now I'm going to bring in our first guest speaker. I'm really excited to have Roz Savage joining us. So Roz is an ocean roar speaker, author, sustainability advocate, and thought leader on the big existential questions of the 21st century. Things like individuals, organizations, global citizens, who are we, where are we going, what will our legacy be? She had an environmental epiphany that led to a career change, leaving her comfortable city life to row across the Atlantic, Pacific, and Indian Oceans. And she's used these adventures to inspire action on our environmental challenges. She now speaks and writes on global issues, taking a systems approach to looking at a sustainable and fulfilling future for our planet. I'm going to bring in Roz live from the UK. Roz, it's so great to see you today.
Wonderful to see you again too, Joe. Thank you so much for inviting me. I wonder if I could kick off by showing a short video. It's about 3 minutes that I think really conveys what ocean rowing looks like and also a bit about the state of my mind and my health while I was rowing. So I'll jump straight into that.
Oh, Roz, can I get you to redo the share? It didn't come through.
Say again.
Can I get you to redo the screen share, Roz? It didn't come through.
I will do that. I'm okay. So glad that you called me.
I didn't want to let it get too far.
Right.
There we go. That's coming now.
Great. Thanks, Joe. Okay, take two.
How can you see into my eyes like open doors? Leading you down into my core, will it become so numb? The spirit's sleeping so long until you find me there, I'm not having a good day. My right shoulder blade was giving me serious jip. Quite a bit of pain with the shoulder and stuff. Why can't I cross the room? My bum is really sore. Just keep going, just keep rowing. It's the trouble with oceans. It seems to be always not enough of something or too much of it. Absolute dead calm. And this is choppy compared with what it was like first thing. The wind is pushing me south. It's being pushed north, you know, south of Antigua, more south. I'm weary and I've been out here for too long and I can't get on the phone to have a whinge to anybody else. Very, very hard going. Oh my God, but it's going to be hard. A strong urge just to curl up in my bunk. Tired, pissed off, sore. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough to take.
So, as you can tell, things weren't going quite according to plan. That was my first ocean crossing, the Atlantic, and everything that could go wrong did. Bits of the boat were falling apart in the very rough conditions, and my body was falling apart. I had pain in my shoulders and saltwater sores. But really what caused me the most trouble was trying to keep it together mentally. And, you know, I was pretty fit physically. I'd done this kind of rowing for many years, although there's a big difference between that and this kind of rowing. But it was, you know, these are huge distances that I was covering of thousands and thousands of miles at a time. Each voyage would take me typically about 3.5 months, which I know doesn't seem like very long compared with 14 months in the frozen north. But to me at the time, in very challenging conditions, it really did take a toll on my spirits, on my mood, and I really did struggle mentally for a lot of that Atlantic crossing. But, you know, as I was saying earlier, it's so important to have a purpose. And Joe, you mentioned that my purpose was to use my adventures to get my environmental message across, that I really wanted to raise people's awareness that we have to treat our planet better. And every single day, that motivation helped keep me going through the dark night shifts all the way across that Atlantic Ocean until at last, to my immense relief, I made it into English Harbour in the Caribbean. And I think if I would say really one thing that I learned about how to maintain mental health apart from having a huge sense of purpose, it was really just to take it one day at a time. And I've been talking about this a lot during COVID, when so many people are really struggling with the uncertainty and often with health issues or with loss, either of their livelihoods or of relatives. It's very easy to get overwhelmed when you start thinking too far ahead. But if we just take it one day at a time, as I learned to do on the later oceans, I really believe that we're all capable of coping with far more than we think we can. And then when it's over and we get to the other side of our ocean, whether that's a literal ocean or a figurative one, it just feels absolutely amazing to be liberated from whatever we've been going through. So that's what I wanted to leave you with. So, Joe, back to you.
Yeah, absolutely. Roz, what an amazing journey. It always blows my mind when I've read a couple of your books and we've had a chance to talk in person. It's just incredible. I'm wondering, you know, compared to when you were preparing for your first journey, the Atlantic, were you prepared in any way at all, or did it was everything just a complete surprise, totally unexpected?
I thought I was really well prepared for the Atlantic. I'd been preparing for 14 months. I'd been spending up to 16 hours a day on the rowing machine, which, apart from anything else, really trained up my boredom thresholds, because there are more fun ways to spend 16 hours. But the conditions were so untypical that year. It was the year of Hurricane Katrina, Rita, Wilma. There were a lot of storms. And it was just much, much harder than I expected. I'd also prepared psychologically. I'd worked with sports psychologists, but I really, I learned it the hard way. You know, I think often those lessons learned on the comfort of dry land, I don't think they really make sense until you're in the thick of it. And it was only as I was going along that I would go, ah, now I get what they were talking about.
All right. Very cool. Well, I'm going to tuck you backstage for now, but we'll bring you in for a little Q&A action in a few minutes. So, all right. Let's jump to our second guest today. Tamara Taggart is joining us today. She is a community leader, activist, veteran broadcaster, and cancer survivor. Born and raised in Vancouver, she's a community leader who advocates for others and raises much needed funds for many important causes. Throughout her career as a broadcaster on local television, radio, and digital media, Tamara has earned her place as a trusted voice for the people of Vancouver. She's focused two decades of volunteer efforts on healthcare and well-being of children and people with disabilities, and in 2015 was awarded the Order of British Columbia in recognition of her years of public service. Let's bring her in now live. Tamara, how are you doing today?
I'm really good, thank you. I'm, you know, on my second cup of coffee. It's only 9:20 here on the West Coast, so still morning here.
All right, excellent. Well, it's great to have you joining us live today. It's fun, you know, to have classrooms joining us from across Canada, from the U.S., Roz in the U.K., Svalbard, and then, of course, you joining us on the West Coast.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing that we can do this. And I think that that's been one of the gifts of this pandemic, is that we have the technology where we can talk to each other anywhere in the world and learn from each other. Listening to Roz was, you know, I felt like, oh boy, I should maybe consider going to the gym soon. I am it's pretty spectacular. And even, you know, Hilde and Sunniva and what they're doing. And I was able to meet them through a podcast that I do and talk to anybody anywhere in the world and ask questions, which has been a real gift during the pandemic.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. No question. And, you know, this is the topic for this month is something that, you know, is clearly near and dear to your heart, and you've dedicated a lot of your time to raising awareness around these issues.
Yeah, when I worked in television, I was in TV for about 22 years, and I found that I really loved my job, but I loved meeting and talking to real people and the experiences that they have in their everyday life. I used to volunteer a lot of my spare time helping to raise money and awareness for other groups. And, you know, people with disabilities. My son has a disability. My son has Down syndrome. So I spend a lot of time learning and understanding and finding ways that I can, you know, move things in a positive direction for other people. When it comes to, you know, our mental health and our physical health during this pandemic, I'm a mom of three kids. And, you know, about a year and a half before we all went into isolation here in Canada, I lost my job. And it was a job that I had for 22 years. It was unexpected. And I guess you could call it, you know, me and my partner that I worked with, we were blindsided. And it did a real number on my own mental health. And because it that big moment came for me shortly after I had, you know, gotten an all clear from having cancer. And what I found personally, one of the things that I'm really good at doing in order to protect myself is I'm really good at pushing everything to the side and not dealing with big things properly as they're happening to me. I'm really good at helping other people deal with things right away, but I realized that I wasn't very good at it. And what I discovered was that your body doesn't forget big things, and it eventually all catches up to you. And it all caught up to me. And I found myself in really big trouble with my mental health. And it was because I just didn't have the ability to be open and honest with myself and talk about my feelings in a healthy way. So it's something that I've really learned to do in the last 3 years, 2 years. And this podcast that I've been doing in partnership with TELUS, which is a telecommunications company in Canada. We do this podcast from my basement office. And it started on March 13th of 2020. And it started as just a way to have longer conversations with people, because we thought the pandemic might last for a few months. Little did we know, we would still be here almost a year later. And it allowed us to have some conversations with not only Canadians, but Americans, people all over the world that are experts in their field, because I'm not an expert when it comes to mental health. I'm not an expert when it comes to COVID-19. I'm not an expert when it comes to, taking care of your money during a pandemic or your own mental health during a pandemic. But what we were able to do was to reach out to experts, and I can have a 20, 30, 40 minute conversation. And it allows access for anyone, anywhere in the world, to listen to the podcast and learn something. And I think that, you know, one thing that I've always known is that we learn from hearing other people's stories and experiences. And I think it's the best way to learn. When I hear Roz talk about her experience rowing, I not only I learn something, but I learn something about mental health and perseverance and your physical health and where were her obstacles. And, oh, I can relate that to something that's happening in my life. I'm not a rower, but there are similarities in her experience to my everyday experience or your everyday experience. And it's same what Sunniva and Hilde are doing. I interviewed them on our podcast, which is how we met. I'd never heard of them before. I had no idea what they were doing. But once I talked to them and had a conversation and understood how they are living in solitude, basically, in the middle of nowhere, and surviving and thriving and sharing information, this helps me understand. So as our podcast, you know, we've just started a new season again, and we're going to keep doing it. But if I'm looking at the list of people that we have spoken to, I spoke to a doctor who specializes in social isolation. He's at the University of Victoria. He was fascinating. Speaking to an expert about the opioid crisis that is happening everywhere, how that affects people that you and I would understand. We would understand their stories. And it makes you care in a way that is more empathetic once you can put a name and a face and a story to something that is happening. We can understand more. And I will say that learning about isolation and the different people that it affects in different ways. One of the people I spoke to is, she is in charge of BWSS, and that stands for the Battered Women Services Society. It's here in Vancouver. And isolation from this pandemic is affecting victims of abuse more than ever. Their phone calls and the need for help has improved. I would never know this information without someone sharing that story and then allowing me to share it with others. So I think that my biggest lesson in taking care of my mental health has been to always feed my curiosity, to keep asking questions, to keep hearing other people's stories, and then finding ways to share those stories. Because when we share, we don't feel alone. And when we hear other people's stories of maybe people who are experiencing the same things as us, it helps us to know that we are not alone, because we never are alone. But one of the biggest things I hear from people in this pandemic is how lonely they do feel. Even if you're living in a house with a bunch of family members, you can still feel very lonely. So it's really been my biggest lesson. And doing something like this and knowing that there's classrooms that are interested in what's happening around the world is really inspiring. I love that there are students and teachers from all over that have joined in on this call. And it gives me a lot of hope that there's a lot of curiosity out there. And I think that curiosity is a beautiful way to learn and to help our own mental health wellness. That's how I'm feeling, Joe.
All right. Well, I love that. One thing that really stood out to me was when you talked about starting the podcast and, you know, realizing you're not an expert in everything and asking for help for the podcast. And I think, you know, there's a stigma around mental illness and asking for help and thinking that you should be able to handle it on your own, when, you know, the best thing you can do is talk to somebody else, share with somebody else, talk to someone who's experienced it.
100%. And that's the other thing. It's, you know, we all need help. No one is an expert at everything. We may have things that we're good at and we are experts in, but it's to ask for help is one of the most kind things you can do for yourself and for others, because it's how we succeed and learn and be better and do better.
All right. Absolutely. So let's bring everybody back in here. I'm going to bring Roz back in. We've got Hilde and Sunniva still on sat phone, I think. How are we doing, Bamsebu?
We are still here.
Good, good. Excellent.
Thank you, Roz. Tamara.
All right. I'm going to open things up now to questions. So we have classrooms who are joining us via camera. A couple of the classrooms are in the classroom, but a lot of them are joining virtually. So their teacher is representing them. And then I'm also going to take questions from the YouTube chat sidebar. So anything's fair game. Questions for Roz, questions for Tamara, and of course, questions for Hilde and Sunniva, and how they're coping up in the north. So let's start off right away. Let's meet a classroom. I'm going to jump over to, let's see, Mrs. Hume's crew is joining us in Leduc, Alberta. Looks like some fifth graders. Let's bring her in. How are we doing today? Oh, Ms. Hume, can you grab the microphone for me? There we go.
Good morning. first of all, I would like to commend all of our speakers and congratulate you for accomplishing your goals so far in your life. One of my students has a question for Roz. How does mental and physical health work? And are they different or the same? And how does one affect the other for you?
Oh, what a great question. And nobody has ever asked me that before. I would say that the pain that I was feeling, both in my shoulders and my backside, definitely affected my mental health. Pain sucks, basically. Or maybe I'm just not very good at dealing with it. But it really gave me a lot more empathy for people who live with pain every day. And I didn't help myself by, I think, responding very emotionally to the pain as well, and sort of fighting reality there. So, you know, mind and body and spirit are all integrated, and they all interact with each other. So again, to come back to that point around purpose that is coming up, I think that's the spirit part. You know, that's when our spirit is strong, we can cope with the physical pain. I hope that somewhat answers the question. I love it that I've been asked a question I never got asked before. I would like to hear that one. Thank you for a really unusual question.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. That came from Dara in our grade 5 class.
Very cool. I want to bring Hilde and Sunniva in on that question. Hilde and Sunniva, looking at the two perspectives, the physical wellness and the mental wellness, how do you find those two are intertwined with what you're doing?
And that is a great question. A lot of people associate accomplishment or achievement or strength as a physical feat. How high can you climb? How far can you ski? How long can you last at Bamsebu? And I think there's a lot of merit around the tenacity and endurance it takes to do those things. But we both, Hilde and I, really feel that the real strength is in the mental tenacity that all of us individuals possess. And, you know, often the people who don't even look the part, those with maybe limited physical ability, are often the ones that possess the greatest mental strength. And so I think as a society, it's good for us to never underestimate the power of the person and the fire inside the belly that exists with each person out there. That's our take.
All right. Excellent. That's a great take. And thanks to our fifth graders for that awesome, awesome question. I'm going to pull another classroom in here with us. Let's see. Let's go. We've got some grade 8s hanging out with us in Brampton, Ms. Fitzgibbon's group. Let's bring them in here. There they are. All right. Hey, Ms. Fitzgibbon, how are you?
Hi, how you doing? I've got my son sitting beside me doing his work too, so we're a little bit chaotic here. My guys had a question for Tamara. They were wondering what she envisions achieving in the next 5 years.
Oh, wow. Oh, my goodness gracious. In the next 5 years. It's so funny because I've always been one of those people that never had a five-year plan. You know what I mean? I've always had like a shorter term plans, and I don't know why that is. Of course, I dreamed of things I wanted to do when I was an adult. And but when it comes to, I know now from, okay, my big goal for 2021, to say this out loud kind of scares me because then you could always come back to me and say, Tamara, have you done that? I want to write a book. I've always wanted to write a book. I have half a book proposal written, and it's a book that, you know, that looks about, it looks at my own journey to wellness and understanding and trauma that comes from, you know, being raised a certain way and then entering into adulthood. So that is one of my biggest goals. And it's not easy to do, you know. I'm so envious of people who can write a book, because it is hard. Gosh, it's hard to do. It's hard to like sit down and really put your feelings out on paper. And I'm a very good journal writer, but writing a book is a totally different experience. So in the next 5 years, I hope, I wish, I want to have a book published. I want to, I want my kids, you know, I have a son in grade 8, and it's not easy being in grade 8 this year when, you know, we have so much uncertainty around us, and it's a new school. And so I really want my kids. That's my biggest, you know, thing for the next 5 years, is to raise really good people that understand what's happening in our world and how we can all support each other. That's my big goal. That's be a good mom.
You and I need to chat later, because I published a book last year.
Ah, there you go. I love it. Awesome. Awesome.
Thank
you. All right. Very cool.
Joe, I see there's something about in the chats. Are you seeing what's happening in the chats?
Yeah, I'm going to bring your question from there. Miss Barr has 6th graders are joining us, and they're in California, but it doesn't look like their camera's connecting today. But they're really curious about podcasts that you would recommend for mental health and well-being for kids. And then also Miss R's class, we're going to meet Miss R shortly. They're curious about the name of your podcast.
Oh, so my podcast is called TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. TT with TT. And it's everywhere you listen to podcasts. There's also a website and a YouTube link, because we do video and we do audio. So you can listen to it, or you can watch it too. You know, my kids have started listening to podcasts at school, and I thought that was really interesting and something that I hadn't considered before. So my daughter came home yesterday and she said, oh, while we were in art class, we listened to this podcast. And it was she's in grade 5. And so I thought it was great that they just had a podcast on in the background while they were all doing art. And it was a storytelling one. So it was really, really good. You know, there's a lot of places you can go to find the right podcast for the age group and stuff. Common Sense Media is one of them, I think. And there's a bunch in Canada that give you outlines of really good age-appropriate podcast, depending on whether you want a story or you want to learn something or you want to hear an interview with something. There's so many out there. It seems like there's millions of them out there right now.
Yeah. Roz, do you have any suggestions? Is there anything you've been really tuned into recently? Oh, Roz, can you unmute for me? It looks like it might have got muted on us. There we go.
I do listen to quite a lot of podcasts. When I was rowing, I used to listen to a lot of audiobooks, which was fabulous. Unfortunately, on the Atlantic, my stereo broke, as you saw in the video, so I couldn't listen to anything apart from singing to myself, which didn't do very much for my morale, because my singing is terrible. In terms of podcasts, my favourite one at the moment, I like the TED podcast, the TED interview, and such like. And there's also one called Waking Cosmos, which might sound a bit pretentious. It's about consciousness and reality and the cosmos, which I find really fascinating, about that kind of metaphysical aspects of our world, if that makes any sense to anybody on this call.
But it's what you said, Roz, it makes so much sense, right? Like even listening to an audiobook, to have that on and just to hear again another story, right? It really can, it does something where it whether it's a fiction or nonfiction, we're able to sort of leave ourselves for a minute and listen to somebody else's story. And I think there's so much value in that.
I'm so grateful to have had both, because I wouldn't have chosen to have 3.5 months alone with my thoughts. And it was absolutely brutal at the time. But to know that I learned so much about myself by just being in solitude nonstop with only very limited use of my phone, because it's so expensive to use a satellite phone. I'm very grateful to have had that opportunity, as we often feel about experiences that were really tough at the time, but we look back and just feel so much gratitude.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I'm going to bring another crew in to join us. They're in class, looks like some eighth graders in Victoria, British Columbia. Miss Fairweather's group, how are we doing today?
We are doing well and super excited to be here.
I love it.
Thank you. Can you hear me, any chance? Yep. Yes. Okay, great. Just first off, huge thank you to all of our presenters who have come in. This has just been incredibly inspiring, and we're going to have some great discussion afterwards. We have a massive list of questions. I'm just going to ask one. we have a question from Amelia, asking for just a description of what an average day in the Arctic looks like for the two women who are up there right now. And an average day, what does it look like for you right now?
Wow, that's a good question. 2 days ago, the sun was less than 6 degrees on the horizon. And that means that 3 months of complete darkness is over, but it's still absolutely dark during the full day. So a day, we live in a small, tiny trapper's cabin built for more than almost 100 years ago. So it's uninsulated. So we start the morning with fire up our wood burning stove to get some heat inside. And then we go outside looking for a polar bear. And if we have this question, so maybe you can pull up the picture we have from the other day, because we have had 4 polar bears at our doorstep now the last 10, 12 days. So a day here in the Arctic is about taking care of ourselves and preventing any burglars like polar bears coming into the hut or taking away some food. We have some polar bear proof coolers outside, and beside the wildlife, which is absolutely perfect and beautiful and then scary at the same time, we do a lot of we drive a drone, and we do a lot of citizen science work, and we also do kelp and the seaweed sampling. And we are in touch with our scientists often, and we try to tell the story from the fragile and vulnerable and beautiful high Arctic. And also editing a book that's going to be published in a month or so. So go, Roz. You will absolutely manage to be you will absolutely be able to publish a book. So it's a full day up in the Arctic. It's isolated and uninsulated up.
All right. Well, great question from our crew in British Columbia. Let's tuck you backstage temporarily. There we go. I'm going to bring in another group. We're going to visit Miss R's eighth graders who are joining us today. They are joining us from Toronto, Ontario, so not too far from me. Let's bring Miss R in. There we go. Hey, Miss R.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for sharing your stories. I had a few questions. I just posted them in the chat, and they've been answered. So I'm really looking forward to that, seeing if the students have interest in following. And one for the pair that are in the Arctic, is there footage that available online to follow for the students, or to see the latest as to what's been happening?
Their Instagram is great. If you've not been to their Instagram account, there's so many photos on their Instagram account, and it really gives you a great look at every day in the Arctic. And I mean, I don't know if I would ever sleep knowing that there were polar bears outside my door. And Sunniva and Hilde, do you still have your dog with you too?
Great question. And actually, we do not have Etra with us right now. And it's actually a really deep sadness for both of us. She is in Longyearbyen, and because it's polar night, just really difficult to get any transportation here. But if we're super lucky, within the next week, we'll have a transport ship come and go slightly out of the way to bring her to us. So fingers crossed, all of you, cross your fingers for Etra.
Yeah, she's a good alarm for those burglars when they show up looking for food.
What is the handle of the Instagram?
The trapper's cabin is Bamsebu.
No, but their Instagram is Hearts on Ice, right?
Yes, Hearts in the Ice.
Hearts in the Ice. Okay.
Go to the press page. There you have a lot of pictures.
Yeah.
On our website, Hearts in the Ice. But I just have to add to the polar bear story because that was absolutely astonishing. We heard a polar bear outside last Wednesday. We had a polar bear here 2 days ago too, but this one last Wednesday actually blocked our entrance door. But we were opening the door, the polar bear was in front of it and actually blocking it. But he got very surprised about opening the door. Luckily, he ran away.
All right. Well, before I jump to another question, I do want to plug two more sites for the students and teachers who are tuning in today. If you visit exploringbytheseat.com/hitty, H-I-T-I, you can find all the speakers who are coming up, the themes for each month. We do two live events each month. You can also find story maps that we've put up with media, images and pictures from Hilde and Sunniva, as well as some of the citizen science projects and some curriculum for students to take a look at. So that's there. And this month, you'll find it there as well. But if you use / mental and physical health, you can go right to that page as well. So do take a moment and check some of those out. Roz, I've got a question online that just came in via YouTube, and I think it's a great one. So, you know, you mentioned that you decided to row to raise awareness about environmental issues. What was it about rowing as opposed to maybe marathon running or cycling around the world or climbing big trees?
Well, I suppose it could be any of those. I was trying to find something that was sufficiently unusual that it would sort of get people's attention for the message. And in all honesty, I had this real passion and this purpose to raise awareness of environmental issues. And I had no idea how to do that. I had no platform, no way at that point of getting people's attention. And then literally this idea came to me sort of like a thunderbolt, completely out of the blue. Yes, I'd rowed, and yes, I knew about this obscure sport of ocean rowing, but I'd never thought that I could do something like that. But it was almost like this, would it be exaggerating to sort of call it a divine intervention or a calling? It just sort of arrived as an idea, like this call to adventure. And I realized that it was actually absolutely perfect, that these were gonna be long expeditions. I posted a blog every day from my boat, and I recorded podcasts from the ocean over my satellite phone. So it actually gave me a real opportunity that maybe people who are into adventure or into oceans or into rowing, but not really into the environment, they would show up for the adventure. And then like once or twice a week, I'd talk about the environmental message I wanted to get across. So it was almost like the adventure was my Trojan horse for my environmental message.
All right, very cool. I'm going to bring in our last on-screen classroom who are joining us. They are in Rockland, Ontario, so close to Ottawa. Some high school students, grade 9, 11, and 12, with Ms. Kraviak. Let's bring them in. There they are. Hey, Rockland.
Hi, how are you?
Good, good. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. So two of the questions that I put in the chat bar have been answered, so thank you very much. The only question I had was, we know that our teens struggle with mental health in ways that we never did as teens due to social media, substance use, and pressure to succeed in post-secondary. If you each could give one piece of advice to teens regarding mental strength and stability, what would you tell them?
Oh boy. Yeah. What would I tell them? Roz, you go first, well, I think, because that is a big question.
It is. So we've talked a lot about coping strategies and that you avoid stress. You can't avoid anxiety. You can't avoid the roadblocks that you're going to experience. And a lot of these kids are heading out to post-secondary. They're going to be independent and on their own. And it's important that we're not throwing our problems aside, but that we're learning healthy ways of coping with it. So it can be something that maybe an experience you had in life and how you coped with it, or a piece of advice that you got from somebody else. But what's just one thing that you would like to resonate with them?
Tamara, I can go first.
You go first.
Yeah. So I don't have children, so I'm going to have to speak as a former child or former teenager. But everything at that age is so intense and it feels so dramatic, and bad things feel like the end of the world. And I think if I could say something to my teenage self, it would be everything passes. You know, it can feel like the end of the world, but everything gets better eventually. Even though it might not seem that way, trust me, it does. Unfortunately, the good times pass as well. So when I was on the boat, I really had to try and keep reminding myself not to get too attached to the good conditions or too despondent about the storms, because eventually it would change. So I wish I'd known that sooner.
Yeah, I mean, I think what I would say is, and I think about this a lot, I had a very, my teen years were very traumatic. I did not have a good home life. And I didn't talk about it. And I didn't, you know, I still have a hard time talking about it. But I do go to therapy. And that's something that I started when I was in my 20s, because I knew that I had to share in order to get through. And what I found in my experience is the only way to heal is to talk to someone, a trusted somebody, or to write. And because I find that when I write, it doesn't have to be a formal journal or anything like that. Just write, even if you write it and throw it out, shred it after, just to get it out. Because resiliency, people talk about being resilient all the time. Well, how do you become resilient? You know, and I watch the trees in my yard, right? I can plant a little tiny tree and the wind comes and it blows it. And I'm like, oh gosh, I should put a piece of, you know, a stake in, a piece of wood in, and tie the tree to it so it doesn't get knocked over. But that's how the tree becomes stronger. That's how that little tiny seedling grows and grows, and it gets in the wind and the rain and the snow and it gets covered, and then it grows and it gets stronger and it puts down bigger roots. So the bad things that happen to us and the things that seem so like they are, it's the end of everything as a teen. It is the end of everything when you're a teen. I get that. And it shouldn't be dismissed, but it's how we become stronger and it's how we learn. And it's the worst when you're in the middle of it. But if you can release it some way by talking to somebody or writing it down, just write it all down and learn from it. And you might not learn right in that moment, but you will later. And it's what makes us stronger and resilient, so that when we do get knocked down later in life, because we will, we can get back up, you know, and we can find our feet again and keep moving forward. I hope that makes sense.
No, that was a great response. That's what I've been teaching them all along. It builds us stronger and we can't avoid it. It's inevitable, but it's we bounce back from that. That's in the long run is going to make us successful people in society.
100%, Karen. And you know what? It's not always pretty, right? Life isn't always pretty. And we have to remember that sometimes when we fall down, it's really bad and ugly and terrible and all of that. But we can get back up. And when we do, we're stronger for it.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Oh, I can't hear you, Joe. You're on mute. That was so fun to say.
Ah, you got me. It does happen sometimes. I think it happens to everybody. But what I was saying was thank you so much for that question. Great question from our high schoolers, and a huge shout out to them, and some really great advice as well. And I think, oh no, we're getting the spinning wheel. Hilde and Sunniva, if you can still hear me, try to exit and come back in again. I saw you for a moment, but then we lost you. So we're going to try and end off today's call with Hilde and Sunniva joining us. We can usually only get signal for, oh, there they are. There we go, coming to us from Svalbard.
Look at those faces.
This is so great. Can you hear us?
Yeah.
We can, yeah.
Wow. Oh, thank you so much, Tamara and Roz. You guys are, that's really, really, for being so vulnerable and showing up.
Thank you. Thank you for connecting everybody. And thank you for doing what you're doing. Everybody
in
the
world.
Yes. You guys are amazing.
Yeah. No, we.
Right back at you.
So wonderful to meet you. And I wish I was up there with you to watch the Northern Lights. It looks amazing.
Joe, are you there?
Yeah, I think there's just a couple second delay. So
they are in the Arctic.
Yeah.
Can you still hear us?
We can, yeah. We can definitely still hear you. When we did this last year, throughout their whole year, we could never do this. The signal, we'd lose them just on the satellite phone multiple times in the call. So
yeah, things have gotten much better. Just one quick point about Sunniva said earlier. It's hard to hear you, but one quick point about something Tamara said about asking for help. You know, when I was on the South Pole expedition, I know everybody on the call can relate to this in some way. You know, I thought I was tough and strong, and we relate strength to the physical part, but the real strength is our ability to admit a weakness and ask for help. And I think that is the biggest thing we can all do for ourselves right now is peel back a layer and
okay. I think we just lost sound, but yeah, absolutely great advice. And it's hard to you know, after doing so many events, to see you guys in the cabin, it's really exciting every time that you're able to pop in for a minute or two and make this connection. I've got you back on the sat phone. Sunniva, you were just telling us about peeling back the layers like an onion. Your video is coming through really well today.
Yay.
No shower. 62 days.
I think Roz can probably talk a little bit about that too, with some of her ocean adventures.
Yeah. 62 days with no shower. Wow.
Oh, we just lost you on camera, but I still have you on the sat phone. You know, I want to do a shout out to our classrooms today. Thank you so much, educators and students, for joining us from Canada and the US. I know we had some people joining from the UK as well. A huge shout out to our speakers. Roz Mara, thank you so much for joining us, sharing your stories, opening up, and, you know, talking about something that is on everybody's mind, I think, right now. You know, how we're coping with this pandemic and our mental and physical health. And then Hilde and Sunniva, always a pleasure. Thank you so much for helping, for pulling these events together and bringing these great speakers to classrooms.
Wow, what an absolute pleasure for us to have all corners of the globe almost literally connected. Thanks to all the students and teachers out there for joining. have any questions, send them to us through our website or our social media channels. We'd love to hear from you. We're not the experts, but we definitely know some experts, as you can tell from the call.
Awesome.
All right. Well, we're so excited for our next event. Looking forward to February, where the theme for the month, we're going to be celebrating women in science, which will be a ton of fun. And then our citizen science theme is ocean plastic. So we hope that you check out the Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants website under the Hearts in the Ice section, and stay tuned for next month's events. For now, everybody have an incredible rest of the week. And again, a huge shout out to Roz and Tamara for joining us live today.
Thank you so much for asking. Thank you.
Absolute pleasure. Thank you, Joe. You do an amazing job here.
All right.
Thank you, Joe. Nice to see you, Roz.
Great to see you too, Tamara. Take care.
Thank you so much, all of you, for joining us today. Thank you so much from the High Arctic.
Yes, so good to hear your voices and see your faces.
Lots of love to you.
Love to all of you.